إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My beloved brothers and sisters, last session we took how practical steps in which a person can take to learn the Quran. So a structured approach in attaining knowledge of the glorious Quran. And we mentioned that there are nine levels, nine stages that a person should come with if he wants to understand the Quran. Nine stages. And from those nine stages, we've taken how many? We only took three. We took three stages. And if we quickly recap on what we mentioned, we said that the first stage is dirasa, that the person studies kulliyatul alfadhi fi tafsir, that the person studies the principles that are in the Quran. Because we said kulliyatul alfadhi fi tafsir, it means qawa'id tafsiriyah, principles that are within tafsir, that you study it and you learn it. And the matnul mu'tamad, the text that we said that you should study on this particular stage, is the kitab husnul bayan fi nadmi mushtarakat al-Quran, written by lil-allama Abdul Hadi ibn Radwan al-Abyari rahimahullah. The second stage, we said dirasatu gharib al-Quran, that you study the strange words that are in the Quran. And the reason why we call it strange is because it is not commonly used. It is not commonly used. So you study those words which are gharib, rarely used. And the matnul mu'tamad, the text that we said you should use, is the book Tuhfatul Arib Fima fil Qur'ani Min al Gharib, written by Abi Hayyan al-Andalusi rahimahullah. The third stage, we said dirasa, to study kalimatul Quran. You study word for word. Each word in the Quran, you study what it means. Whether it's strange, whether it's not. Every word in the Quran. And we said the matnul mu'tamad, the text that one should use, is the kitab Kalimatul Quran Tawdihun wa Bayan, written by Muhammad Hassanain Al-Adawiyyu Al-Azhari, rahimahullah. Today we're going to start from the fourth one, inshallah ta'ala. The fourth stage that one should come with, which is Dirasatu Al-Wujuhi Wal-Nadairi Al-Qur'aniyah. This is Al-Alfaz Al-Qur'aniyah, the Qur'anic words, Al-Muttahad Al-Muttahidati Lafzan. Al-Muttahidati Lafzan. Al-Alfaz Al-Muttahadatu Lafzan. The wordings are the same. The wording is what? The same. Oh, Aslan, or the root word is the same. But what? وَالْمُخْتَلِفَةُ الْمَعْنَى. But the meaning are different. It's one word. It's what? One word. Or both of these words go back to the same root. Root word. I'll give you an example. The word Al-Husna and Al-Husna and Al-Husna, all of it are what? One word. What about Ihsan and Al-Muhsin? Are they the same word? No. But do they go back to the same root word? So it could be the same word, or it can go back to the same root word if the meaning is different. If the meaning is different, in one verse it means something, and another verse it means something, this is called Al-Wujuh Wal-Nadair. What is it called? It is called Dirasatu Al-Wujuh Wal-Nadair Al-Qur'aniyah. I'll give you an example. Bukhari narrated in his Sahih, min hadith al-A'mash, an Abi Wa'il, an Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, lamma nazala qawluhu ta'ala, when the ayah came down, الذين آمنوا ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم أولئك لهم الأمن وهم مهتدون. This ayah came down. This ayah says, الذين آمنوا, those of you who believe, ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم, and they did not clothe their iman with oppression. They didn't garment their iman with oppression. They didn't do that. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. Those people, they have safety. وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ, and they are truly guided. So what had they not come with? They did not come with ظُلْم. And they did not also cover the iman. Those people are going to gain two things. What is it that they're going to gain? أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. Safety is for them. Allah is going to make their land safety, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to protect them. Also, وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ, and they are guided. They are what? They're guided. When this ayah came down, جَاءَ أَصْحَابُ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, the companions, they went to the messenger صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, and they said to the Prophet, أَيُّنَا, which from amongst us, لَا يَظْلِمُ نَفْسَهُ, which from amongst us does not oppress himself? Who from amongst us does not come with oppression? Who doesn't do it? That's what they said. And then the messenger said to them, لَيْسَ كَمَا تَقُولُونَ, the matter is not what you're saying. It's not how you understood it. It is not what you think. So what is it? أَظُّلْمُ الشِّرْكِ, the ظُلْم that is being referred to in this ayah, it means a shirk, associating partners with Allah. And then the messenger then said, أَلَمْ تَسْمَعُوا, did you not hear قول العبد الصالح, the statement of the righteous slave of Allah, meaning Luqman. Have you not heard the statement of what? The righteous slave of Allah, يعني Luqman. What did Luqman say? He said, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Shirk is a what? Shirk is, it's a great oppression. Two things we benefit from here. Number one, Luqman is not a prophet. Because the prophet referred to him as what? Abdul Salih. And if he was a prophet, then that would be a station higher than just being a righteous slave. It would be higher than that. Because the prophet referred to Abd Salih to who? He referred that to Najashi. The Prophet said, today, a righteous slave of Allah died. Come, let's pray on him. Also, the Prophet gave the title Abdus Salih to Abdullah ibn Umar. When Abdullah ibn Umar had a nightmare and he woke up, and then he came to his sister Hafsa and he told her the night, the dream that he had, that he saw the inhabitants of the hellfire and he was scared that he was going to go into it. And then the angels dragged him out and they said to him, you're not from the inhabitants of the hellfire. The messenger said, when he was told the dream, Hafsa went and she told the Prophet. The Prophet said, Abdullah ibn Umar is a righteous slave of Allah, if only he prayed Qiyamul Layl. So the word Abdul Salih is for a person who is lower than a prophet. Are we all together? So Luqman is a slave who was righteous, a righteous slave of Allah. The second thing that we take from it, which is what we want from it now, is the Prophet explained here of dhulm to mean what? A shirk. But there's another ayah where the word dhulm is used in it. There's another ayah where the word dhulm is used in it and it doesn't mean shirk. Where Allah says, وَمَا ظَلَمْنَاهُمْ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. Allah says, وَمَا ظَلَمْنَاهُمْ, we did not oppress them, وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ, but they oppressed themselves. The word dhulm here, does it mean shirk? What does it mean in this ayah? It means al-intiqasu ala nafsi wal isa'ati ilayha. It's to transgress on yourself. It's to come with sins. So the word dhulm has once been used as shirk, and in another place it has been used as what? A sin, just a mere sin. A crime that you did. And also dhulm is referred to as what? Going against Allah's command in the rights of another person. If you do something wrong to another person, is dhulm. Even this word, dhulm, you have to study it under this chapter, which is Dirasatu Al Wujuh Wal Nadair Al Quraniyah. One word, different meaning. And it's something you should look into. And the beauty about this one is that the difference between this one and the first one which we mentioned, which is Dirasat Kulliyatu Kulliyat Al Afad Fi Tafsir. The first one that we took is that the first one is that this word comes in the Quran always in this meaning. Whereas Dirasat Al Wujuhi Wal Nadair, that one word comes in many different meanings. And it's a problem if you don't distinguish one from the other, because you're going to make a verse or give a meaning to a verse that it doesn't carry. Are you with me, brothers? Another example. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-Qasas, وَلَمَّا وَرَدَ مَاءَ مَدْيَنَا وَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّةً مِنَ النَّاسِ يَسْقُونَ. Allah is talking about two women who, some of the scholars, they say that were the daughters of Shu'aib, and that is not correct. That wasn't Shu'aib's daughters. Rather, the man in this story is not Shu'aib. It's a righteous slave of Allah. It was a noble, righteous man. His two daughters, they came to a well wanting to take water from it. So Allah says in the ayah, وَلَمَّا وَرَدَ, when they came down to the valley, when they came down to the well in order to get water out of it, وَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّةً, they found there an ummah. An ummah here means طَائِفَةٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. Ummah here means what? A group of people. What did they find? They came to the well, they wanted to take water out. What did they find? وَلَمَّا وَرَدَ مَاءَ مَدْيَنَ وَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ يَسْقُونَ. They saw a people who were throwing their bucks in and they wanted to take the water out. So the word ummah here, what does it mean? طَائِفَةٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ, a group of people. What about the ayah, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً. Ibrahim was a ummah. What does it mean? The word is the same. Ummah was used in the other ayah in Surah Al-Qasas. And here Allah says Ibrahim is a ummah. Does Ibrahim is a ummah mean here ta'ifatun minan nas, that he's a number of people? Is that what it means? No, well, it doesn't mean that. It means كان قدوة في الخير. Ibrahim is a role model in good. ولذلك some of the scholars, they said that this word Ummah has 9 meanings. And some scholars even said 8. So it's one word has different meanings. A person should study that. The book that you should look into if you want to know this more, and the Matnul Mu'tamad, the text that we recommend that you look into in order to learn these words, is the kitab Nuzhatul A'yun al-Nawadir fi ilm al-wujuhi wal-nadair. And it's written by Abi al-Faraj ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah. The kitab is Nuzhatul A'yuni al-Nawadir fi ilm al-wujuhi wal-nadair, written by Abi al-Faraj ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah. This book is very good, and it is the best that's written in this field. But again, it requires ila sharhin aw hashiyatin alayh. It requires somebody to explain it and to place a footnote on it. It doesn't have any of that. It doesn't. And one of the other books that I would recommend that you use with this kitab of Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, the Nuzhatul A'yun al-Nawadir, the book that I will recommend that you also use is the kitab Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha by Ibn Faris. Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha is a dictionary. Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha. It's a dictionary. And it's written by Ibn Faris rahimahullah ta'ala. The beauty about this book, Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha by Ibn Faris, is if a word has many meanings, what does it have? Many meanings. What he will try to do, Ibn Faris, is, for example, if there's 10 meanings in this word, he will try to bottle it down to the bare minimum that he could, that all the 5 can fall under. If he can use one meaning to bring it all together, he will say, this is the one meaning that all of those 8 fall under. And it helps you because you don't have to know many meanings for one word. His kitab, his mu'jam, this is the unique benefit that it has and you could benefit from. Number 5, the fifth stage that one should take if he wants to understand the book of Allah. If he wants to understand this glorious book, the fifth stage that you should do is go through maqasid al-suwar. Dirasatu maqasid al-suwar. What do? You study maqasid al-suwar, the objectives of each surah. What do? You study the objectives of every surah. Every surah in the Quran, there is a maqsad in there. There is a what? There is an objective in it. The person, he sits down and he studies the objective in that surah. For example, Surah Al-Ikhlas. What is the maqsad of Surah Al-Ikhlas? At-Tawheed. The objective of Surah Al-Ikhlas is what? At-Tawheed. Which type of Tawheed? Tawheed ilmi khabari. The Tawheed which is based upon affirmation that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, His names and attributes. And also what? Tawheed amali, which is that you don't associate partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together, brothers? Every surah that you do, you try to understand the objective of this surah. Because when you read it, what will happen? You'll understand what this surah and where it's taking you to. It will benefit you in that regard. And the best person who did this is Al-Allamah ibn Ashur. Al-Allamah ibn Ashur, rahimahullah. His tafsir is like that. Before every surah, he will mention for you the maqsad, the objective of the surah. Ibn Ashur does that. Ibn Ashur, what does he do? Before you go to any surah in the Quran, he will tell you the objective of the surah. وَلِذَلِكَ he said in the muqaddimah of his book, in the introduction of the book, before he started the tafsir, he said the following. He said, وَلَمْ أُغَادِرْ سُورَةً إِلَّا بَيَّنْتُ مَا أُحِيطَ بِهِ مِنْ أَغْرَاضِهَا. I have not left the surah except that I have given you the objectives that are in that surah. I've given it to you. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ النَّاظِرُ. So that when you look at the Qur'an, the reason I did this is because when you look at the Qur'an, لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ النَّاظِرُ. So the one who's looking at the Qur'an, في تفسير القرآن مقصورا على معرفة بيان مفرداتي, that it doesn't just become learning the words and what they mean. The reason why I gave you the objective of each surah is so that when you look at the Qur'an, you don't only look at it in terms of its wordings, but you look at it in terms of the wisdom behind every surah. Are we all together, brothers? And that's very powerful. The book which is mu'tamad, the book that I will urge you to try to read here, is a sheikh who's mu'asir, who's alive right now. His name is Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Hamad, who lives in Zulfiqas al-Qasim in Saudi Arabia. What he did was, he took out from Tafsir ibn Ashur all of the maqasid al-suwar, and he made it into one. Rasuli, he didn't change a letter or a word. Are we all together? Instead of you having to read Tafsir ibn Ashur, all of it, what he did was he brought it all out for you. And he called it أَغْرَاضُ صُوَرُ الْقُرْآنِ الْكَرِيمِ فِي تَفْسِيرِ التَّحْرِيرِ وَالتَّنْوِيرِ لِبْنَ عَاشُورِ أَغْرَاضُ صُوَرُ الْقُرْآنِ. What he did was, he brought it all out and he made it into one. That's the best one that should be looked into and read. And if anybody of knowledge could explain this book or place a hashia, a footnote, a commentary, تُبَيِّنُ مَعَانِيهِ, so they can clarify the meaning in it, then that would be something very good. And this again, it proves to us the statement of Al-Imam Zarkashi, that the science of Qur'an is a science, even though it's the greatest science, the book of Allah, it's a science that hasn't been really served that much. Nearly all of these books, they don't have shuruh and hawashi on it, commentary and explanations on it. And wallahi, brothers, as I said last week, if you really want knowledge, good knowledge, if you want understanding, then what you need to understand is that the Qur'an has all knowledge. All of knowledge is in the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. وَلِذَلِكَ Abdullah ibn Mas'udin, he said, as Ibn Abi Shayba narrated in his Musannaf, مَنْ أَرَادَ الْعِلْمَ فَلْيُثَوِّرُ الْقُرْآنِ فَإِنَّ فِيهِ عِلْمَ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ. Abdullah ibn Mas'udin, he said, مَنْ أَرَادَ الْعِلْمَ, anyone who wants knowledge, فَلْيُثَوِّرُ الْقُرْآنَ, let him look at the Qur'an. Let him research inside the Qur'an. Let him try to bring out the gem from the Qur'an. فَإِنَّ فِيهِ عِلْمَ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ. Because it has the knowledge of the early generation and those who came before you, and it has the knowledge of those things that are going to happen that haven't happened yet. The Quran has all of that for you. So a person should look into it. The sixth level, the sixth stage that a person should come with if he wants to understand the Quran and he wants to be able to follow the ayah, أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا أَفَلَمْ يَتَدَّبَّرُوا الْقَوْلَ. If you want to follow those verses, you have to take these stages, brothers. It's vital. The sixth stage is دراسة, to study مجمل التفسير, the overall meaning of the tafsir. The overall meaning of tafsir. In other words, you're not going into details. You're not learning the word, the ayah word for word. You're not doing that. What you're doing is, you're studying and you're learning the overall meaning in each verse. Each verse, the overall meaning. Without going into great details, without learning it word for word, the overall meaning that is in each verse. Dirasatu mujmal al-tafsir, which is al-tafsir al-wajiz al-kafir bi bayan al-ma'ani al-kulliyah li ayat al-Qur'an al-Karim. If you do this, the benefit that it will give you is you will look at the verse from outside. Whereas when you go into word for word, not everything you've understood word for word, have you actually understood the overall meaning? Are we all together? A person may be able to explain each word for you what it means in a language, but not understand what it means. Are we all together? وَلِذَٰلِكَ مُجْمَلُ التَّفْسِيرِ is the benefit. And the kitab, which is the most beneficial in this regard, وَأَكْثَرُهَا نَفْعًا وَأَعْظَمُهَا دَوَرَانًا, the book that is the most common, and it's also great, and it's beneficial, is Tafsir al-Jalalain. Tafsir al-Jalalain. And Tafsir al-Jalalain is written by, and the reason why it's called Jalalain is because two Jalaluddins wrote it. Huh? Tafsir al-Jalalain, who wrote it? Two Jalalain. Two Jalal. One is Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. And the second one is Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli and Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. They both wrote it together. One is a teacher and one is the student. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli is the teacher and he's the senior. And Jalaluddin al-Suyuti is what? He's a student. When you read this tafsir, you have to understand the way that they wrote it and the way that they put it together. Or else what will happen is you will misquote it when you're using the book. And what is that? Jalaluddin al-Mahalli, he started from Surah Al-Kahf to Surah Al-Nas, is Mahalli's tafsir. From Surah Al-Kahf to Surah Al-Nas is Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. Are we all together, brothers? From Surah Al-Kahf to where? To Surah Al-Nas is written by who? Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. And then when Jalaluddin al-Mahalli wrote it from Surah Al-Kahfi to Surah Al-Nas, which is half of the Quran, right? Surah Al-Kahfi is the 15th juz. And the Quran is how many ajza? 30 juz. 30 ajza. 30 ajza. So he did half. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli, he said to himself, oh, I might as well do the whole Quran. Let me finish what I started. So he went to Surah Al-Fatiha. As soon as he finished Fatiha, he died. So what did he do? He did from Surah Al-Kahf to Surah Al-Nas and Surah Al-Fatiha. That's Jalaluddin al-Mahalli's tafsir. From Baqarah to the last ayah in Surah Al-Isra. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli started from Surah Al-Kahf. And Suyuti, where did he stop it? The ending of Surah Al-Isra. The ending of what? The ending of Surah Al-Isra. Are we all together, brothers? This kitab is very beneficial. And this book used to be taught from the time Suyuti died onwards. It was taught in Egypt. They used to give a lot of importance to it in Egypt. And they used to study it. And then it moved to Hijaz, the Arabian Peninsula. It moved to the Arabian Peninsula, Hijaz. Then they took it on board and they gave importance to it. And there's two books that are running besides each other. One is Jalaluddin, Tafsir al-Jalalain, which is the one we spoke about, and Tafsir al-Baydawi. Tafsir al-Baydawi, it was given a lot of importance to by the Turks. In Turkey today, that's the tafsir which is mu'tamad. and those lands. Tafsir al-Baydawi. And Tafsir al-Baydawi has been served. It has 100 sharah and hawashi, ta'liqat, 100. Tafsir, what? Tafsir al-Baydawi. Tafsir al-Jalalayn, lakin, Tafsir al-Jalalayn is now present in Egypt, is still taught. Ard al-Hijaz is taught. Even when I went to India, I saw it was taught. Afghanistan, they teach it, and those lands. Tafsir al-Jalalayn, it has two hashiya, two commentaries that are on it, which both of them can be benefited from, which is hashiyatul jamal and the hashiyatul sawi. Hashiyatul jamal and hashiyatul sawi. Those two hawashi, they will benefit you. Level six, seven, sorry, sah? The seventh stage, al-martabatu sabi'ah, the seventh stage, the seventh level is dirasatu, to study mutashabihu al-Qur'an. What do you study? The mutashabihu al-Qur'an, the verses that are similar, that look like each other. For example, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Ali Imran, Allah says, قَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. That's what Surah Ali Imran says. Surah Al-Baqarah, what did he say? وَقَالُوا, the wow is not in Surah Ali Imran, but Surah Al-Baqarah it is. وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً. مَعْدُودَاتٍ and مَعْدُودَةً. The wow is there, the wow is not here. You study it. Why? Why is there a wow in the not in the first one and in the second one? Why is the first one ma'dudat in Surah Ali Imran, and in Surah Al-Baqarah is what? Ma'duda. What is the reason? So mutashabih means these two verses, they're different. What are they? They're different. And there's a reason behind it. For example, if in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, Rabbi ja'al hadha al-balada baladan amina. رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا. Surah Al-Baqarah. So Allah says, رَبِّ جَعَلْ, oh Allah, make هَذَا this بَلَدًا آمِنًا. Surah Ibrahim, what did Allah tabarak wa ta'ala say? رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا ال, so has alif and lam in there. هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Why is the first one nakira and the second one is mu'arraf? Why is the first one indefinite and the second one is definite? What is the reason? This is a dirasa. So it does, of course, stimulate the mind of the person who's memorizing the Quran, because it's mutashabih. Allah says in the Quran, Allahu nazzala ahsan al hadithi kitaba mutashabihan. The Quran, this is mutashabih. And it also is something that you need to ponder over when you look at the meaning of the Quran, because there's a reason why one is different from the other. I want to mention a benefit here. Are we all together? I want to mention a benefit to show you the power of this concept. And the mutashabi, brothers, it deals with at-ta'khiru wa-taqdeeb. One word has been put before the other word. But this other verse, no, this one was put before this one. Or al-hadfu ama-ziyadat wa-nuqsan. Something is added and something is deducted from this one. Are we all together, brothers? That's mutashabih. Why is that word dropped here and not here? Why is this before this one and this one before this one but not here? Are we all together? This is mutashabih. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, let's take an example for this one. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says to us in the Quran, وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. Allah commands us. When you read the Quran, what do? Do isti'adha. Seek refuge in Allah from the what? The shaytan. Isn't that what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said to us? He told us to seek refuge in Allah from the what? from the shaytan. Why is isti'adha not an ayah from the Quran then? Why is it not an ayah in the Quran? This is dirasatul mutashabihi, mutashabihi fil Quran. Why is the isti'adha, seeking refuge in Allah from shaytan, why is it not now a verse part of the Quran? We're studying now. This is the dirasa and the studying of what? Al-mutashabih. The verses that resemble one another. The scholars, they gave three meanings, three reasons. The first one is the reason why it wasn't made an ayah from the Quran is because once you're reading the Quran already, seeking refuge in shaitan is not needed because he's too weak. He's what? He's too weak. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala wants to prove to you the other ayah where he said, Inna kayda shaytani kana da'ifa. That the plotting and the planning of shaitan is very weak. Once you've already started reading the Quran, you wouldn't really need to seek refuge in Allah within the Quran, because shaitan cannot come close to a person who's already reciting the Quran. That's one fa'idah that some of the scholars, they brought from it. The second is because that our speech that we were saying before we were reading the Quran should be distinguished from whence you start reading the Quran. And so if the isti'adha becomes part of the Quran, then what's the thing that's going to distinguish the Quran from the speech that you were saying prior to when you intended to read the Quran? Sah? I'm talking right now. If I want to read the Quran, what would I need to do? Say something that's not part of the Quran, so I can start fresh. I can start the Quran. This is a unique thing for the Quran, which is what, brothers? That the Quran, there has to be something before it to indicate that you're now going to start the words of Allah. Whereas if you're speaking to someone and you want to speak to another person, you don't have to say something new to distinguish their speeches from one another. Sah? Am I making sense here? وَلِذَلِكَ after you do finish the Quran, there's no evidence to say anything, because you would have to distinguish that from the people's speech. Are you with me, brothers? So there's nothing that you say after that. You don't say Sadaqallahu al-Azim, nor do you say a hadith that Al-Imam al-Nasa'i narrated in his Sunan al-Kubra, in which he chaptered a bab where he said, Bima tukhtamu al-Qur'an, that which you conclude the Qur'an with, and hadith Aisha where she said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا جلس مجلسا, that the messenger was one that if he sat in a gathering أو قرأ قرآنا or he recited Quran, he صلى الله عليه وسلم would say سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. After you finish the Quran, Imam al-Nasa'i is trying to say that you should say this, and that is weak. That is what? That is weak. It's not authentic. After you finish the Quran, there's nothing that you say. Because that would mean, once you finish the Quran, you would have to distinguish the Quran from the speech of the creation, and the creation's speech is of no value for you to. But the Quran, when you want to read it, you have to clarify it and distinguish it from the statement of the people. Number eight, the book that's mu'tamad, the book that you should read here for the seventh is Kashful Ma'ani fi Mutashabihil Mathani. Kashful Ma'ani fi Mutashabihil Mathani. That's the book that you should look into. And it's written by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Jama'a. He wrote it. And they said the reason why he wrote it is after he finished teaching the tafsir of the Quran, some questions were put to him, and he was asked questions, and so he saw it upon himself to write this book. The eighth stage The eighth stage, which is dirasatu mufassalu tafsir, studying the tafsir in details. You're going to study it with what? In details. What does it mean here that you study in details? It means that you now study it with the application of other sciences. إذا التفصيل المستوعب المفرد لكل آية منها آيات القرآن على وجه التفصيل لا على وجه الإجمال على وجه الإجمال لا على وجه الإجمال. It is the opposite of the other one that we mentioned, which is the دراسة مجمل التفسير. تفسير الجلالين was what? It gives you the what? Overall meaning of the verse, right? This one, what does it give you? It gives you a detailed meaning of the verse. How does it give you a detailed meaning of the verse? It will bring you either another verse that's explaining it, or it will tell you what it is in the Arabic language, or it will tell you what? The Sahabas, what they said it is. Are we all together? What the Sahabas said, it is. Or what the Sahabas said, it is. And the tafsir that should be looked at here is the tafsir of Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah. The tafsir of Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari, an Imam al-Tabari's tafsir, which is called Jami'ul Bayani fi tafsir al-Qur'ani. Jami'ul Bayani fi tafsir al-Qur'ani. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's tafsir is the best in this regard. ولذلك Abu Bakr ibn Khuzaymah, he said, لو أن أحدا رحل إلى الصين, if anyone traveled to China, for what? فيه, for this tafsir book, لكان ذلك قليلا, we would consider that to be very little. You haven't done much. And he's talking about a time when the tafsir was what? Sorry, when traveling was what? By horse? Was it by horse? No, it was by horse. It wasn't by airplane. He said, if you actually took a horse and you traveled to China, and you traveled to what? And you traveled to China, your traveling would be considered little. لو أن أحد رحل إلى الصين, if anyone traveled to China for this book, Tafsir ibn Jarir al-Tabari, لكان ذلك قليلا, that would be very little. And Ibn Jarir mentions in the beginning of his tafsir book what he's going to do in his tafsir. He says the following. He says, وَنَحْنُ فِي شَرْحِ تَأْوِيلِهِ وَبَيَانِ مَا فِيهِ مِنْ مَعَانِيهِ مُنْشِئُونَ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى كِتَابًا مُسْتَوْعِبًا لِكُلِّ مَا بِالنَّاسِ إِلَيْهِ حَاجَةٌ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ جَامِعًا وَمِنْ مَسَائِلِ الْكُتُبِ غَيْرِهِ فِي ذَلِكَ كَافِيًا وَمُخْبِرُونَ فِي كُلِّ ذَلِكَ بِمَنْ تَهَى إِلَيْنَا مِنْ اتِّفَاقِ الْحُجَّةِ فِيمَا اتَّفَقَتْ عَلَيْهِ الْأُمَّةُ وَاخْتِلَافِهَا فِيمَا اخْتَلَفَتْ فِيهِ مِنْهُ ومبين علة لكل مذهب من مذاهبهم وموضح الصحيح لدينا من ذلك بأوجز ما أمكن الإيجاز في ذلك وأخصر ما أمكن فيه الاختصار. He said, I'm going to mention all of the views in one verse. I'm going to bring the Arabic language. I'm going to bring the difference of opinion. Why the difference of opinion is there? I'm going to go into great details. So this tafsir book by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, it's very, very big. And it's very wide. The last stage is dirasatu, to study ahkam al-Quran. The last stage, it is to study the jurisprudence of the Quran, the ayats which are called ayatul ahkam. Ayatul Ahkam, what does it mean? Ayat related to fiqh. As-salah, as-zakah, as-sawm, al-hajj, al-buyu', al-nikah, al-talaq, and etc. It deals with hukum, ahkam, jurisprudent rulings in this particular verse. The best book that's been written in this issue is the tafsir of Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi rahimahullahu ta'ala. Tafsir al-Imam Al-Qurtubi. He called it Al-Jami'u fi Ahkam al-Qur'an. Al-Imam Abi Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Qurtubi, he has a kitab called Al-Jami'u fi Ahkam al-Qur'an. This is the best. And once you read once you read Qurtubi's tafsir, it is good to read with it Al-Muharrar al-Wajiz, written by who? Ibn Atiyah. And also Ahkam al-Qur'an of who? Abi Bakr ibn al-Arabi. Read it with Qurtubi's one. Are we all together, brothers? Al-Muharrar al-Wajiz by Ibn Atiyah. And also Ahkam al-Qur'an with Abi Bakr ibn al-Arabi. If a person does those 9 stages, brothers, and he does it consistently and continuously, and he looks at them, he looks at each and every one of them, he will come out with durar, gems. ولذلك ابن أبي حاتم, he mentions in the muqaddimah of his kitab al-Jarh wa al-Ta'dil that Abdullah ibn Wahb ibn al-Masri, Abdullah ibn Wahb, he said, كنا نعجب, we used to be fascinated with who? من نزع مالك من القرآن. How Imam Malik can extract something from the Quran. We used to be amazed how he used to do it. We were shocked with how Imam Malik would bring an ayah, how he would bring something out of it. فسألناه أخته, we went and we asked his sister. We said, how is Imam Malik able to do this? فقالت, she said, أما إنه مالك إذا دخل البيت, when he enters the house, لم يكن له شغل, he had nothing else he busied himself with. إلا قراءة القرآن, except that he read the what? Except that he read the Quran. Soon as he entered the house, he would open the Quran and he would look at it. So he had all of those 9, of course. And when he looks at the Quran, what is he going to look like? Something else. It looks something else to him. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. All of that which I mentioned, brothers, is books that you should study with a teacher. There should be somebody who goes over these books with you. They are not books that you pick up yourself and read it. It is something that a teacher would go over with you. And it would be a teacher to explain it for you and the meaning that are in it. And anyone who wants to gain knowledge, brothers, there are 2 strengths that are needed. And if you don't have both of these strengths, you won't really learn. The first of them is قُوَّةُ الْفَهْمِ. Have to have the strength of understanding. You have to be a person who grasps knowledge. قُوَّةُ الْفَهْمِ. And the second one is قُوَّةُ الْحِفْظِ. Have to have the strength of memorizing. وَلِذَلِكَ شَيْخُ شُيُوخِنَا Ibn Mani', he said, أَجْمَعَ الْعُقَلَ All the wise people, all of the wise people, they unanimously agreed upon عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَا يُنَالُ That knowledge cannot be gained إِلَّا بِحِفْظٍ except that you memorize it. Knowledge cannot be gained if you don't memorize it. وَلِذَلِكَ خَلِيلُ بْنَ أَحْمَدِ الْفَرَاهِيدِ What did he say? He said, الْعِلْمُ مَا حَوَاهُ الصَّدْرُ وَلَيْسَتْ مَا حَوَاهُ الْقِمِطْرُ Knowledge, it's what's in your chest and not what's on paper. Because what's on paper, we all share it. Tafsir Mujarid al-Tabari, you can read it and I can read it. That's not knowledge. It's for everybody. Real knowledge that you can claim is what's in your chest. وَلِذَلِكَ they used to say knowledge is what you take with yourself when you go to the toilet. That's the real knowledge. Are you with me, brothers? So since I mentioned the books that you should understand, and we spoke about the first strength, which is Al-Fahmu, I want to talk about the books that you need to memorize. And there are 4 books. If you want to learn all of this which I mentioned, 4 books you have to memorize, and these 9 levels you need to go through. The 4 books that you need to memorize is, the first one is Al-Bayanu لِمَا خَفِيَ مَعْنَاهُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ الْبَيَانُ لِمَا خَفِيَ مَعْنَاهُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. This is a book written by Sheikh Saleh ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi. And he organized it from the book تُحْفَةُ الْأَرِيبِ فِيمَا فِي الْقُرْآنِ مِنَ الْغَرِيبِ, written by Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi. He took it from that book. So that's the first book that you memorize. The second book that you should memorize is حُسْنُ الْبَيَانِ فِي نَظْمِ مُشْتَرَكَاتِ الْقُرْآنِ, written by Al-Allama Abdul Hadi ibn Radwan al-Abyari rahimahullah, which we mentioned. The third book that you should memorize is إِمْدَادُ المستشير بأصول الأحاديث في التفسير. إمداد المستشير بأصول الأحاديث في التفسير. And this is written by, it's written by الشيخ صالح بن عبد الله بن حمد العصيمي. And this book is like بلوغ المرام. بلوغ المرام, what is it? أحاديث الأحكام, right? Isn't Bulugh al-Maram Ahadith al-Ahkam? This book is Ayat al-Ahkam. Ayat al-Ahkam. The fourth book that you should memorize is Al-Fiyyat ibn Alim al-Warjalani al-Jazairiyu. Those four books, if you memorize it, and you go through those nine stages, so you memorize those four books that I mentioned, and you go through those nine stages with a teacher, and number three, you supplicate and you beg Allah and you humiliate yourself and you humble yourself for him and you beg him, fi duja al-layl, in the mist, the darkness, the last third of the night, to make you understand the Quran, inshallah ta'ala, you will gain the understanding of Allah's book, and Allah will honor you subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I wanted to conclude with lines of poetry that Al-Imam Al-Shatibiyyu said in his kitab Hirzu al-Amani wa Wajhu al-Tahani fi al-Qira'at al-Sab'ah. Al-Imam Al-Shatibiyyu, he concluded it with these couple of lines. He mentioned it at the ending of his nazm, and he said the following. He said, "Riwa al-qalbi dhikrullahi fastasqi muqbila wa la ta'duru dhadh-dhakirina fatumhila wa athiran al-athari mathra ta'dhibihi وما مثله للعبد حصنا وموئلا ولا عمل أنجى له من عذابه غداة الجزاء من ذكره متقبلا ومن شغل القرآن عنه لسانه ينال خير أجر الذاكرين مكملا وما أفضل الأعمال إلا افتتاحه مع الختم حلا وارتحالا موصلا سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليه